Good morning. My name is Patrick Pannuto. I'm a PhD student at the University of Michigan, and I'm here today to talk about sensing, sensors, data, and all the things that work around that. Data is empowering, and you can do really powerful things with data. So at the University of Florida right now, they're doing a pretty basic thing, where they stick a soil moisture sensor in the grass, and they only water their lawn when their lawn needs water. You never have the problem where you drive home in the rain and you're watching your neighbor's automatic sprinklers water their lawn in the rain. They don't do that anymore. And that's what you can do with a little bit of data. With that same data, that soil moisture data, when you blow it up and you look at continent scale, at global scale, you can do things where if you look at the continental soil moisture data, you can form rainfall predictions much better. About 20 years ago, we figured this out. It's one of the first examples of where sensors turn to big data, turn to a result, and our estimates of where it rains, when it rains, and how much it rains is much better as a result of this. And the talk that comes after me is going to talk a lot about how to use big data, how to process big data, how to get interesting things out of big data, but I'm here to talk about how to get that data. So where does data come from? Data comes from sensors. So sensors, what are these things? They are something that gets data from the physical world to the digital world. All right, they allow you a way of accumulating information. They allow you a way of getting data and doing things with them. And the other thing that they really provide for you is they're automated. They don't require that you walk out there and you walk into a room with a thermometer and write down the temperature every day. It does that for you. It allows you to do things where you install a water pump in Nairobi, and now I can sit in my lab here in Portland State, and I can say that half my pumps are working, half of them are kind of working, one of them is totally broken, and I'm missing information about one of them. It gives you this kind of technology, it gives you this kind of ability, and this is what data does. But in terms of actually building out deployments, using sensors, using data, and getting from end to end trying to build these things, there are a lot of problems along the way. So we have this sensor. The sensor has picked some information out of the physical world, brought it into the digital world, and now what do we do with it? So when we start trying to plan a deployment, when we start trying to build sensors, when we start trying to actually do interesting things out of them, the first question you need to ask is, how often do I need to get data from my sensors? Because this is going to inform a lot of the decisions you're going to make. And there's a spectrum here. So your first one extreme, you have the real time. You have something like the Global Seismographic Network that has sensors all over the world. They're collecting it in an aggregate place. It's coming in real time, and they're trying to estimate when earthquakes are going to occur. You have this immediate feedback of data. All right? You have kind of a mid-range view of the world where you have, say you want to do tracking of animals. You want to understand where they move through their habitats, when they eat, when they see sun, when they go to water. So you put some sensors on a bird. The bird flies around, and periodically he flies by one of your base stations. And periodically you get some data back out of it. And that's good enough. You don't need to know where this bird is every second of every day. You're much more interested in where it's been over time. And at the extreme of this, you have the single dump view of the world. And we're actually going to use the exact same sensor we used in real time. We're going to look at a seismograph again, but now we're going to use it in the context of, I want to go out and I want to do infrastructure modeling. I want to understand, is this building sound? It's been built for 5-10 years. Is it still going well? So what you do is you put highly accurate seismographs all over the building, you give it a big whack. You go out, you pick them all up, and you analyze this data. So there was no need to get any feedback, there's no need for any of this real-time, any of this communication. And what this really does is, by deciding how often you need to get data back from your sensors, it informs the most important question you're going to ask: how am I going to get data off of my sensors? How am I going to get data from my sensors to wherever I want to actually use it? And this turns out to be perhaps one of the most important questions in building the deployment. So what this means is, for every class of the sensing that I talked about, with the exception of the one big dump of data, in addition to sensing, in addition to taking the information from the physical world and putting it into the digital world, you also need to add some form of communication. So the sensor needs to have a little bit more. And all forms of communication are not created equal. So let's take as a slightly more specific example. We are going to look at the power usage of a building, of a home, or something along that nature. And I would like to understand, man, I got my power bill this month, and I used way more energy, and I don't understand why. I mean, I live in a rental house. I guess I have fridges that aren't the best appliances in the world. What is it? No, but I bought a TV. I bought a new 60-inch plasma, and man, that thing is great. But is that costing me a lot of money? What is it? what is it that is consuming all of my energy? Where is it going? And if you wanted to ask this question a year ago, you would buy one of these. And what one of these is, this is a WhatsApp. It is a sensor that plugs into the wall. You plug your refrigerator into the WhatsApp, and it's got a little screen, and it says your refrigerator is using 200 watts. And I walk next door, and I put it in the next fridge, and it says this refrigerator is using 300 watts. And I say, oh, well, clearly fridge one is better than fridge two. And that's great, but it's very manual. It's very annoying. It's very painful. So you wanted to add some communication. So that little blue word .net on it, they got this great idea, and they said, well, let's connect our WhatsApp to the internet. We're going to add an Ethernet port, which means you can plug a cable into it. Now we get data to the cloud. Now it's great. Now we can communicate. And if you want to do a whole home deployment and measure all the power usage in your home using WhatsApp.nets, it looks like this. And, well, this is something of a joke. This is something of seriousness. What you have done here is you have added an infrastructure cost. Whenever you try to add communications to a deployment, whenever you rely on that, you are adding an infrastructure cost. Now, there is the wired infrastructure that you have here, which is the infrastructure that you have when you need wired connections, Ethernet, LAN, things like that. So how do we get rid of this tangled, wired, awful mess? Well, you move forward, and you have this great new product from Belkin. It's the Belkin Wemo Insight. And this is everything the WhatsApp was, except instead of having an Ethernet port, now we connect to Wi-Fi. And the problem is solved. I no longer have wires rolling over my house. I simply plug this into the wall, plug my fridge into this thing, and it all just works, right? Sort of. What we've done is we are still relying on some hidden infrastructure. My house did not come with Wi-Fi. This building did not come with Wi-Fi. At some point in time, someone went through and they installed routers. They installed these wireless routers and they built a lot of infrastructure so that we could use this communication backhaul. And yes, if you are on a college campus, odds are pretty good. There is Wi-Fi right here, right now. You can use it. It will work. It will get your data back. If you are in the middle of the Saharan desert, odds favor, there is not Wi-Fi, it is not going to work, and it's not the way you're going to get your data back. And it turns out there is no truly ubiquitous communications infrastructure. There is no one single thing you could put on your sensor where you could put this sensor anywhere in the globe and it guarantees to get data back. That simply does not exist. So you have to consider where you're trying to get data from, what kind of data you're trying to get, what the fidelity, what all the time style of information is about this data in order to properly inform what kind of deployment you want to do. The top is looking at cellular, and the bottom is looking at satellite coverage and things like that. So we've started to build something of a deployment now. We have an idea of what kind of data we want to get. We have an idea of how often we want to get it. We have an idea of how we're going to get it. But there's one remaining problem. These sensors themselves are not free, right? Humans walk around and we are powered by food, and that was what was powering the old survey takers. But now, sensors do not love on run, hopes, love, and dreams. They run on energy. So the next question you ask is, how am I going to power these sensors that I'm putting out in the world? And these are informed by the answers to your previous questions. If you're building the batch offload model, it's pretty easy, right? If you're going to collect data for 30 minutes, you need a battery that lasts for 30 minutes. Problem solved. Battery lasts for an hour over provision, fine. But if you're going to collect data for 3 months, put a 3.5 month long battery and move on with things. If you're going to bother to wire this network in, if you're already going to run wires to communicate data, the relative cost of adding wires for power is relatively low. So where things get interesting are wireless. And wireless is really appealing. Wireless is extraordinarily appealing from the deployment perspective because it's so easy. You take this sensor, you put it where you want it to measure something, and you walk away. You don't do anything else. It is the dream of the deployment story. But there's a fundamental problem. You have this little box, and when you put it out in the world and you shipped it there, it shipped with a finite quantity of energy. It was put into the world with all the energy it's ever going to have, and what you have done is you have put a device out there that has a lifetime. Eventually it's going to deplete its energy reserves, and now it's just a useless piece of plastic sitting out in the world. So, this is kind of an open question in the wireless sensor network world. That's where a lot of the research is being done right now. How can we transform wireless sensor networks from devices that have lifetimes to devices that are set it and forget? You put it out there, it lasts forever, and never has a lifetime issue anymore. Clearly, you've been watching enough late night infomercials. So there's this idea, do we actually need a battery in a wireless sensor network? And the realization is, if we have light around, if we have other sources of energy around, we can harvest energy, right? I said that you ship this thing with a finite quantity of energy and it was only going down. Well, what if we could make it go up? And the answer to that is yes, of course we can make it go up. This is fairly easy. Solar cells work well enough, and we can put them out in the world. They're pretty big. And you have some studies. UMass did one where they were evaluating the turbidity of rivers. And then CSIRO, they did one out in forests. And what they found is that you could almost eliminate this lifetime problem. So the trajectories are a little washed out, unfortunately. But if you look at the bottom center picture from the CSIRO, there are three solar panels there, two on a bit of an angle and one is flat. The two on an angle look gray, discolored, and otherwise weathered for having been out in the environment for about 2 years. The flat one is the reference solar cell, what it was like when it first went out. And the efficiency of this thing fell about 6% over 2 years. So that's not terrible. Still works great. System's working great. But it implies that there does still exist a lifetime. You've just drastically extended the lifetime by doing this kind of thing. So we've talked a lot about how to build a deployment, how to go out, collect data, how to power data, how to do these kind of things. But I'd like to take a second to actually look at the sensors themselves. And up until now, we have discussed what I would call traditional sensing. If I want to go out and measure the temperature of this room, I'm going to buy a temperature sensor. But if you walk through a little story with me, you're going to see that that's not always the best choice. So you come up to me and you say, I need a sensor that measures water flow. Okay? We can do that, but I'm already worried. My head is starting to think, and I'm thinking to myself, okay, so I have to come up with some way of attaching this water flow sensor to wherever the water is flowing. And I've got a lot of electronics that are kind of sitting near water, so I've got to figure out how to make that work. So tell me a little more about this thing. You say, well, I want to be wireless and I want it to last for 7 months because I want to do a nice deployment of this. Great. So now my waterproof box is holding my electronics, is holding a big battery as well, and I'm kind of reasoning this out to you. And you say, whoa, you can't have a big battery. I'm putting this thing in bathrooms. You don't want big batteries in your sinks. And I'm saying, and this leads me to ask the most important question, what are you actually trying to do? And they say, I want to measure if people wash their hands after they use the toilet. And some folks from UCLA came up with a pretty cool idea for this, and they realized that you don't want a water flow sensor to do this, you actually want a temperature sensor. So bear with me, how do you use a temperature sensor to figure out if someone has washed their hands after they've used the toilet? And it's a pretty neat idea, and the idea is pretty simple. If you are sitting along, you put a temperature sensor on, and you walk, if you walk into your kitchen, and you turn on the kitchen sink, and you turn on the hot water does not come out. 10 seconds later, hot water comes out. Why? Because there's a run of pipe between this reservoir of hot water and you. And between the hot water tank and the actual faucet, that water in that pipe has reached the ambient temperature of the building it is in. Right? So when you run water through the pipe, the temperature of the pipe is going to change. Now, in the hot water case, this makes a lot of sense. It seems pretty easy. Hot water is going to raise the temperature. It turns out that we don't keep our buildings at 55 degrees, which is what it generally is underground. So when you start running cold water, you're actually going to lower the temperature of the pipe. And they found that they can measure this with fairly good accuracy. They even found that you can measure how long the water was flowing based on how much the temperature has changed. So it turns out that you can do some really interesting things to sense something by using a side channel approach, by looking at this from not the direct thing you want to measure, but finding something that is easier to measure that still answers your original question. And this is where we get into some of what I think is the cooler research that's kind of on the cutting edge of what's been happening in wireless sensing networks recently. And this is where we're going to combine these last two ideas. We're going to combine this idea of energy harvesting with side channel measurement. And we're going to introduce what we call the Manjolo principle. Does anyone know what a Manjolo is? It is a Portuguese water hammer. So the idea of this device is it was used for crushing meal, crushing wheat, crushing corn, things of that nature. And you basically have a large scoop on the end of a lever with a heavy rock. And what you're going to do is you're going to slowly fill this scoop with water from a river. Eventually it's going to fill, the lever is going to come up, the scoop will dump out, and it will slam down. And it will continue to do this ad infinitum. The rate of this water hammer is going to be proportional to the flow of this stream. Everybody with me? So what we're going to do is we're going to build a sensor based on this same analogous idea. So I would like to ask, how much energy are coming from these lights? Are these lights turned on? well, I can't really find the plug for these lights. That's very hard to do. What I can do, though, is I can put a solar cell in that light. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put a solar cell that's slowly harvesting energy from that light. If that light is on, it's going to harvest energy much faster. I'm going to use this harvested energy to send a packet out to the rest of my network and what have you, right? So when the light is on, I send packets way more often. When the light is off, I send them very rarely. What this means is the frequency of transmission, how often I was able to harvest energy, how fast I was able to harvest energy, is actually the sensor. The ability to harvest energy becomes the sensor. So it's a really neat integration of these two ideas. And I can show you a little video of this actually working in practice and part of the motivation for this. So I said a little while ago, I wanted to measure the power usage of everything in my house. And that's kind of a pain to walk around and plug these devices in everywhere and things like that. It's a lot of unplugging, replugging, I have to reach behind the fridge, it's very manual. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this same idea, but instead of using solar cells, I'm going to use magnetic cores. So you can clip a magnet over a wire and harvest energy based on how much current is flowing through it. So we're going to exploit that, and up here. Excellent. So this is the circuit panel in my house. I opened the circuit panel, and I clipped on these little blue things onto every wire. And you can kind of possibly not see in this video, unfortunately, but occasionally a little LED is blinking every time it is charged up enough to send a packet. So the total time for me to install whole house energy metering for my house was about 5 minutes. And that is what is enabled in this case. It is not that we couldn't do energy sensing before, it's that it was a pain to deploy it. So now we can do both of these things. And we can actually take a quick aside here, take a look at a live demo of this data coming in right now. And we can watch the energy coming in my house, watch the energy as it's used, and see what is going on. So what's happening at the top is you have ground truth meters, those watts up I showed, and at the bottom you have all these little energy pulse meters. And you can see there's a correlation between the heights of these two lines. So we can use these much lower cost, much easier to deploy, much simpler sensors instead of these much higher complication sensors like the WhatsApp. Great. So throughout this talk so far, I have ignored something. I have neglected what is possibly the most deployed set of sensors in the world. What am I talking about?
Mobile phones.
Mobile phones. That is exactly what I'm talking about. The smartphone is this wonderful device, and you can do lots of cool things with it, even from really simple ideas. So a really simple idea is I would like to understand the reliability of the power grid, our being the theme of this talk. And we come up with this idea that, generally speaking, when you unplug your phone, you've picked it up to unplug your phone. So your phone is in one of two states. It is either charging or not charging. When you transition from charging to not charging, if you are doing it yourself because you've unplugged your phone, it's probably associated with a motion event. So now we have a very simple filter to detect grid outages. And it turns out to do this in practice, you have to do a little bit more. You can exploit some neat properties, such as when you turn on the audio front end, you can actually hear the ambient 60 hertz wave that's around, and things like that to improve the reliability of the system. But from a first order, what we have is an extremely simple system with extremely low impact onto the phone. It's very low impact for a user to simply sample the accelerometer for a couple milliseconds every time you unplug it, and you can do global scale blackout detection. So we're just starting the attempts with some collaboration from the folks at the Dell Lab in Berkeley to try and get this sent out to Kenya to see how this works. But in the more general sense, smartphones have a pretty diverse array of pretty powerful sensors. They have accelerometers, gyroscopes, magnetometers, GPSs, cameras, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they have communications built right in, right? They have cellular communication, they have Wi-Fi, they have Bluetooth, they have NFC, they have all of these unique ways of getting data on and off of them. And it's kind of leading to a trend in the general sensor networking community. So what I have at the bottom here is I have Sandy Penland's work from MIT on building what he calls sociometric badges, which I'm guessing a number of people in the room are probably familiar with. It's trying to estimate the user interactions of people. How long do I talk to people? How long is an interaction? What is it about? These kind of things. Who do I see most? What are my social networks? And those kind of questions. And in 2006 and 2007, he was building custom hardware, because that's what had to be done in order to achieve this. But by 2009, he switched to using just the mobile phone and building apps on top of the mobile phone. And every one of the sensors that were on his smart edges have migrated to the mobile phone, except one. What he had was, at first, an IR-based emitter, and secondly, eventually ultrasonic. And the goal of that was to identify whether I am talking to you or whether we are sitting at a table back to back. Because the problem with using these things to estimate range, things like that, is Wi-Fi is wonderful. My phone will connect to the internet if the access point is right here and I'm facing it, or I'm facing away. But this is a problem if I'm trying to estimate who are you facing at these tables. So you need something directional. And that is a sensor the smartphone doesn't provide. So he found some other solutions to that, but it turns out this is a more general problem. There exists this wonderful sensing platform, the smartphone, you'd like to be able to use and exploit, but there are sensors that the sensing platform doesn't expose to you, doesn't have. So the question is, how do you extend the smartphone to support other types of sensors? I'd like a Geiger counter. I want an EKG monitor to do mobile health. I want a simple thermometer. I'd like to do soil moisture sensing. I'd like to do air quality monitoring. And this is a problem we've investigated as well. And the solution to that is to exploit this one ubiquitous port that is on all of these phones, and that is the headset port. And you can do much the same thing that the square reader and other types of things that you may have seen in everyday to day life, where you extend the smartphone to add an additional type of sensor, an additional type of thing to make it work for your application. And this is a really nice property, a really nice thing that you can do with smartphones. So the takeaways I'd like you to get from understanding the general sensing world here is if you can think of something you would like to measure, it can be measured. Very often I find that I'm talking about the research, the kind of things that we're doing, and people say, that's so cool. You can get that data? We never knew you could get that data. The answer to this is I want you to try and change your frame of mind. Any data you want, we can get. Any data you want, we can get. And if we can't get it, it's a very interesting research question, and you can find someone motivated to work on it and fix the problem. Anything you want, we can get. The problem is, sometimes it's expensive, and measuring it directly may not actually be the best approach. And we started to look at that water-based example, things like that. And when you try to, it remains an interesting research problem to take something that is expensive to measure and make it cheap to measure. It remains an interesting research problem to take something that is difficult to deploy and make it easy to deploy. All of these things are either solved problems or interesting problems. Well, the other constraints, when you're going out to try and build things, the constraints on data collection are really going to define the rest of your system. In the rare case, that's not true, but at the very least, it's a very good place to start. And lastly, a lot of the sensor research is trending towards using smartphones, and that's nice for doing general purpose research, but it's not the best thing in the world in all cases. Smartphones can be relatively expensive, but they do have the advantage of you can run multiple apps, multiple sensing applications on them, or you can reuse them in future deployments and things of that nature. And before I kind of leave from here, I'd like to say a little bit of what we'd kind of like to get back, we, the sensor network community, from you, the USAID Developing Economies community. And this kind of alludes to the first point, problems, challenges, things that you can't measure, we need them. Like, we're running out of things to sense. We can get all the data we can possibly want. We think it's interesting. We have it all. So what is interesting to collect? What are we missing? And then what constraints aren't we seeing? What don't we understand about getting data out of these systems, getting data back to places that are usable? What could we do to make these things easier so that they're actually deployable systems for you? Because that's the two kind of dimensions we work in, is how do we get more data in the first place, and then how do we get this data in a way that people will actually use it? And the other thing is something we wanted to starting to address a little bit. We have a bit of a cultural problem. We are scientists, and we love data. And I showed you this thing a moment ago where I was giving you a live view into my home. And you could see all of the power usage of my home. And anyone with an internet connection could see the live view of the power usage in my home. So I captured this morning. And this is in the event of the bathroom turning on at, let's see, 6:41 a.m. And then if you look a little bit later in time, you can see the bathroom turned off at 6:57. And I can tell you that my roommate Murray took 16 minutes and 30 seconds in the bathroom this morning. He doesn't know that I know that.
He does now.
Perhaps. This is a problem, right? We're so excited to catch data and things like that, and we're so excited to do things where if we look at this power usage and we can show people that leaving the fridge open causes energy to last longer, we want them to solve problems. But we don't think about the longer implications of what happens when we start providing this kind of feedback to users and what the greater social implications of what we're doing are. We're so excited to get the data, we don't really look past that. And it's certainly, I don't mean to speak for everyone in the community, but it's something that is pretty pervasive. Thank you very much for your time. And the last thing I'd like to say is I have lots of cool hardware with me. If you guys want to see some of these sensors, some of the things that make it all work, I'd invite you to come stop by.